here in the perimeter, there are no stars. Out here, we is stoned, immaculate.
Hello and welcome. This is the C86 show. I'm David Eastaugh. As you know, we love a special guest. This week, it's going to be the turn of AR Kane, because I recently spoke to Rudy Tambala. To find out more about life, love, poetry and all that other groovy stuff, this is the interview, so I won't bore you anymore. So after several minutes of casual chat, which was fascinating, which gets edited out, we got down to that very exciting subject that was the early formative years and those early musical awakenings. Anyway, Rudy, tell us more, tell us now.
I don't think I had a musical awakening. I may have had one, but I've forgotten it, so it wasn't that profound. If it did happen. But I mean, similar to you, I grew up in the 70s listening to all of the kind of glam pop,
yes,
glam rock. But I think the split was being we were from like immigrant families, we had like a black cultural strain running through it. So, you know, when you watch Top of the Pop, we always kind of sat there, you know, with bated breath waiting for the Soul Train moment where you'd get the Temptations or the Shy Lights or the Detroit Spinners or something,
yes,
like that.
So Barry White.
Well, not so much Barry White, to be honest. We were more into dance and soul and jazz funk. So there was all of the pop music, but we really loved the soul music as well, as it was called in those days. I think it might be called R&B these days.
Yeah, I was very confused with R&B when suddenly it happened recently. Well, 10 years ago.
Well, yeah, R&B. I mean, R&B was originally evolved into rock and roll, didn't it? And it was rhythm and blues.
Yes.
From the 1940s and 50s. And then it got adopted as a term for soul music in the probably the 90s, I think, 80s and 90s, that's become R&B.
Yes.
But my musical moments, I suppose, would have been kind of being in small kind of community centre discos and things, listening to the Sound of Philadelphia and things like that. Some of the disco stuff, Crystal World, Crystal Glass, and just that, and some of the dub reggae that would be played by the sound systems at the end of the evening.
Yes.
So similar, but a different strain in there, I guess, as well.
I was a bit too young for the wonderful world of punk rock. Did that sort of come into your consciousness at any particular time, or was it a bit late?
So I'm a couple of years older than you. I was born in 1962. Punk rock was very, very prevalent, actually. It was interesting because when it came around, I remember we all kind of took our flared trousers, turned them inside out, stitched the line down them so that they were drain pipes, cut off the excess and had drain pipe trousers overnight kind of thing, all shaved our heads and kind of started dressing differently and acting a little bit more, even more arrogantly and horribly than we had been as teenagers before that. So, I mean, 76, I was 14, that's a very impressionable age. But the punk thing really, in East London and West London, where we used to hang out, the punk thing really kind of crossed over with the dance scene. I think that's really where the new romantic thing came out. So there was definitely a big crossover there.
Yes.
Yeah, and very, very influential on AR Kane's sound.
Yeah, absolutely. And did you, I mean, as we, because in sort of, you would have been that age where you'd have really had that leaving school probably in the late 70s. Did you leave at 16 or did you stay on? And
I left at 18, actually, and went to university.
Right. So you had a grant, you had freedom, you had sort of a new world.
We had a full grant. And yeah, it was absolutely, those were amazing times, I suppose, for.
You got a check for something ridiculously high, didn't you? Never seen such money.
it was a large amount of money. And then you lived on a camper, so you lived in a complete fantasy world. And it was really, I mean, it was lovely. I can't knock it at all. I look at, you know, my daughter now is at university and having to save up all this money to put her through it. And they're going to come out with thousands of debt regardless. It's just like crazy.
Yes, it's my brother who studied in the 70s. I mean, he saved money. I mean, to be honest, he was a bit of an accountant at the time, so he was always going to sort of come out of it. And the bizarre thing, I know without going into it, but you could also sign on during the sort of holidays, couldn't you? You could claim unemployment benefit in sort of, you know, even Easter as well as, you know, Christmas. And
yeah, I mean, there was a lot of social financial support in those days.
There was a lot. What did you study at university?
Biochemistry.
Right. My God, you were going to go for it, weren't you?
Yeah, but I found out that I wasn't actually that good at biochemistry after a couple of years, because I mean, I just didn't have the interest or the application for that kind of level of research. It started to bore me. I liked the big ideas, but I didn't really like, you know, the pets. You know, 0.5 milliliters of this and extract that. I found it really, really tedious and boring. But that's the nut. That's the crux of it, really, to put in that really, really hard
decision.
Work.
Yes. Yeah. So when you went to university, did you start sort of experiencing that wonderful world of just endless gig nights and disco nights? And
it wasn't so bold as it is now. You know, it's like when people go to university now, it's all laid on. I mean, we had a union bar, which was a fucking dive. You know, it was a shanty shack, really, prefab almost. And it had very, very cheap booze. And so we went there every night. And occasionally there will be a disco. and two or three times a year, there might be a band come down. I saw Sweet, interestingly, in 1980.
Blimey.
They weren't as good in 1980. They didn't dress glam anymore, but they were still a good band.
Yes. What university did you go to?
It was Royal Holloway College, University of London.
So right.
Near Windsor.
Yeah. And were your parents at all, or did you have any musical members of the family who sort of were turning you onto different sounds?
Yeah, all my family are musical in one way or another, mostly consumer music. My mum is a massive classical fan. So we had Bach and the Viennese waltzes playing constantly. And she also loved anything that was kind of a slightly exotic sounding, like soca and reggae and ska and stuff like that. So there was a lot of music in the house.
My God, that's so cool.
I have three older brothers as well, and they were relentless clubbers. My oldest brother was in a sound system, so he brought home a lot of like reggae and dub records. And then my second older brother was really into more the soul jazz funk scene, so he brought home a lot of records, and we just used to sit there and play them over and over again.
Yes. So, yeah, this is what we do when we're young. We consume it. Well, also getting hold of these things was quite tricky, and they sometimes required weeks or sort of months of saving some money to buy a record.
Yeah, my brother spent practically all their money on clothes and records. So every Saturday afternoon they would go out and they'll come back from the West End, and they would have some shrink wrapped gem that went on the decks, and you weren't allowed to touch it.
Oh, but God,
was,
no!
But it was amazing. Actually, there was always music, and all my friends loved music. My musical taste changed when I got to university, interestingly, because I was exposed to, I suppose, what you might call white middle class musical interests, because I was kind of black working class. So the white middle class was very, very different. There was a lot of rock music, you know, like Zeppelin and Yes and Genesis and all this kind of stuff, which I liked. I really, really, I mean, not so much Zeppelin, but I liked the prog stuff.
Yes.
Probably is reflective in our music to a certain extent in some of the kind of ambientness and complexity.
That's quite interesting in that sense, that I suppose your degree would have put you into that world of nerdiness, because my brother, who I just mentioned, is 7 years older, and he was, his period was the prog rock period of, you know, Yes, Genesis, Wishbone Ash, Balkley, James Harvest, the solo work of Rick Wakeman, and the few sort of Steve Howe albums, as well as Black Sabbath and Deep Purple's early albums.
Don't forget Pink Floyd.
Yes.
Which is more 60s and 70s, I suppose. But
I think he quite liked the early stuff, like Umba Gumba, and got very excited when you could listen to someone walking from one speaker to the other in stereo. I think, oh, and Tubular Bells. Jesus, everyone had Tubular Bells, didn't they?
Yeah, well, we just did a cover version of Grantchester Meadows, which I think is on Umba Gumba.
Right.
We just did a cover version to play live last weekend. You know, that was really good fun.
Yes.
Never thought of doing a cover version of a Pink Floyd song. But
so that's kind of slightly surprising in the 80s, because by then prog rock was kind of embarrassing. And I mean, Roger Dean posters had all been sort of recycled or just thrown in landfill. But how come you didn't sort of suddenly embrace that post-punk?
Well, I did at the same time. That was part of it. So there were these. So two of my best friends went on to form a band called Kitchens of Distinction.
Oh, my God, Patrick.
So it wasn't Patrick, interestingly, it was Dan and Julian, because they were at the same university as me.
Oh.
And they were my best mates. But Patrick, obviously, was in the band. But when I was at uni, I was kind of like their roadie. Dan and Julian had a band. and they had a bass player who wasn't Patrick, and they used to do covers of rock songs, like, I don't know, Spirit of Radio and
classic rock,
Bastille Day.
Oh, like, my God, even better. So I love that one.
So I got introduced to all of this rock music, and I just hung out, helping with the drums and stuff, but didn't actually play. But I slowly picked up the guitar from Julian and started to learn from it. But at the same time as all of that stuff, which was stuff that they would have come with, there was a kind of an undercurrent of things that we also liked, which were kind of a bit wonky but the same. So we all liked the Velvet Underground, for instance, and we kind of all quite liked 60s psychedelia, English and American psychedelia,
right,
stuff like that. So there's a crossover there, and I think also at that age, about 18, you're starting to experiment with psychedelic drugs and stuff.
Yes,
I'm sure they start a lot earlier now, but that's when we started. So we kind of, anything that kind of was in that zone, and if you were in the 80s, the only real psychedelia was 60s, whereas now we've got layers and layers and layers of it, you know, from the whole rave scene and stuff. So you kind of got into a lot of 60s music. But I remember Julian really getting into Joy Division. And so we listened to a lot of Joy Division, and that kind of took us off at a tangent. And then slowly kind of Joy Division went into listening to the Cocteau Twins and, you know, so, and all these kinds of things, and the Smiths and so on. So all of that kind of post-punk new wave stuff.
Yes, I know.
And then some of the gothier stuff as well, probably.
Did you get into kind of the club scene? There was like, was it Alice in Wonderland and that kind of new Paisley, kind of slightly West Coast, birdsy kind of vibe as well?
No, not really. When it came around to clubbing, I mean, I would go back to London most weekends when I was from university, and they had what we called warehouse parties, which later became known as house parties, but they were literally in abandoned warehouses. And that would have been people like a really, really young Pete Tong DJing, and people like,
right,
and playing, you know, classic dance music, you know, kind of pre house and kind of jazz funk and stuff like that. You know,
so. Did you start to kind of embrace the other sort of side of the early 80s, that period of 83, 84? You know, things like that cool, I suppose, jazz funk fusion. I'm thinking of
not the acid jazz scene.
No, I suppose it was people like Working Week, and I suppose before that you had Sade and people. There was this kind of quite cool dance scene that started to develop.
There was a kind of you know, just before the acid jazz scene, there was that kind of almost cocktail jazz stuff that
yes
they were doing. And even the girl did some jazz tracks on their Eden album and things like that. And it was really nice, but it wasn't a scene. They were records you listened to or stuff that was on the radio.
Aspire to being on the Face.
Yeah.
It was all very cool, wasn't it, really? So then when did you make that decision that you wanted to suddenly not just be a punter, but to be part of a band?
So I think... So my schoolmate from when we were 8 years old was Alex, and we always shared music, and we argued about it constantly. Because my background was more soul, jazz, funk with a sprinkling of reggae and rock, and his was more kind of like dub and reggae with a sprinkling of jazz funk.
Right.
So we went out clubbing together, but we crossed over to different scenes. But then when we got into that kind of feverish consumption of something new, which was probably around the early 80s, when I remember we went to a show to go and see, I was just speaking about Tracy Thorn and Ben Watt. Before they were together, the Marine Girls.
The Marine Girls.
I remember seeing them at Kingston Poly in like 1981. And I think that was when we started to move into a different zone about thinking and talking about music in a different way and going out and seeing bands, rather than going clubbing. And I think that was a bit of a shift for us. And then the turning point, I think, was we both saw Cocteau Twins on the tube on TV and were blown away by what we were seeing. Just the use of technology was the thing that was so humorous and so obvious. So they didn't have a drummer. They had a tape machine playing behind them.
Yes.
We both kind of tweaked our funny bone, but also at the same time, the sound was different. They look different, you know. Lizzie's voice was extraordinary. You know, Summer Emmon had those great big chords that he played on the bass, which was, you know, I guess from Peter Hook, really, but you know, it sounded amazing to us. Because unless you listen to like jazz, you didn't hear that style of playing.
Yeah.
And then you know, Robin's guitar. I remember we saw that and we decided we were going to start a band that evening, you know, on the telephone.
Right.
We went round and we started playing on Alex's battered old acoustic guitar and we couldn't play anything. We were saying, how do we get that sound that he got? Can't get it out of this acoustic guitar. So we went down to Denmark Street in the West End, London, and we just went into a shop and just said, Cocteau Twins, how do you get that sound? This bloke went, oh, you want one of those and one of those and one of those, mate. So we bought them. we bought an electric guitar, we bought a distortion pedal, we bought a digital delay, and we bought a Roland drum machine.
Just like that, you went, that's it. My God, that was quite brilliant though, wasn't it? I mean, it was quite handy. The person in the shop knew what to buy, but...
Yeah, I mean, a lot of these people that work in these shops know music inside out, don't they?
Yes, at least but to be on the zeitgeist is always quite impressive as well, because, you know, some people might have just been still wanting to hear the kind of opening riff to Focus or Stairway to Heaven, but no, he was there, really.
I mean, that's the funny thing, going into those stores, you always heard people playing these hackneyed old rock riffs, and I remember we would go in there, we would just turn everything on full blast and play feedback and get chucked out really quickly.
Yes, and then sort of as the 80s progressed,
yeah, I mean, excuse me, I just got this spam caller keeps on calling me.
Oh well, there you go. It's nice to be wanted, isn't it? did you sort of feel that you were starting to be part of that kind of zeitgeist, you know, that kind of musical zeitgeist of the 80s? Because one thing I've noticed that there were so many different scenes, but also the kind of wave of music that started to appear was quite colossal, you know, and anybody could do anything. So you had the
I think there was definitely this feeling that anyone could do anything. And that came from the punk era, that DIY mentality. And we didn't feel, and also, like I say, I'm seeing, we don't need a drummer, we just need a drum machine or a tape machine, you know, and being kind of almost naive, so naive that it seemed arrogant, but we just couldn't believe that we could fail because we had ideas and we had a lot of music in us.
Yes.
But we were very ignorant of the scene, because what we didn't know is there was a thing called the indie scene. I remember we played a gig supporting the Kitchens of Distinction. I think it might have been our first live show. In just off Oxford Street, and we played this show, and this couple came up to us afterwards, and we didn't know they were producers, and they said, "Wow, that was fantastic! Wasn't expecting that. It was really indie." And because this woman who was speaking to me was American, I thought she meant music from Indianapolis. I was thinking, "I wonder what music from Indianapolis sounds like." I didn't know she meant independent record music. That's how ignorant we were, you know. But you know, it's different things, isn't it? For me, it's always been about sound.
Yes.
Sound and rhythm, I suppose. But, you know, if you heard Vinnie Riley playing guitar, or like I'm in love with a German film star through the Echoplex, or The Cure even, you know, on some of their songs, the Cocteau Twins sound was already there. It already existed. But the way that Robin did it was different. And that captured our imagination in a way that nothing else had, really. It was just like this effortless wave of sound and noise.
Yes.
But in terms of a scene, I don't know if there ever really was a scene. I mean, I've no idea. There was just a lot of music around.
I suppose there was labels, weren't there? There were the kind of, from anybody from Creation to Glass Records to, you know, obviously there was Rough Trade and the Smiths kind of relationship and One Little Indian. So obviously you were sort of ticking all those boxes. And 4AD, you know,
Yeah, 4AD was definitely a label which had an identity, largely from Cocteau Twins and Vaughan Oliver, and then Ivo being the maestro behind it. And it had a certain aesthetic, which once you got into, you just wanted to buy everything that came out, even if you didn't like it. And there were some bands on the label which had fantastic artwork from 23 Envelope and B23, but the music wasn't that great. I didn't care because I wanted the artwork, you know, which is another side of it.
Yes.
In retrospect, it's easy to package things up, which is kind of what we're doing now in a sense. But, you know, there was like the Smiths, the Cocteau Twins and New Order. And they were like the three styles, if you like. You know, you've got your space cadets out there, then you've got your bedsit people, and then you've got your fucking in your face lads, you know, that just want to get smashed and dance, you know. but you know, simulate trying to simulate all of that. But people tended to be in one camp or another.
Yeah, it was a very tribal time. I mean, now you just wonder why everyone had to sort of, you had to one, like one thing or the other, but you couldn't sort of cross over. Whereas I couldn't at the time, like, I suppose, a lot of electronic stuff, like, you know, Depeche Mode. But now I think, oh, God, actually, they were quite good. But then I associated them with a scene which I'd also projected stuff onto that I thought, no, I'm just definitely, that's not my scene at all. That's just.
Yeah, that's interesting. Is that the first actual vinyl that I bought? First record I bought was The Human League, Travel Log, which was their second album. And it's because I'd really got into the new romantic thing. And so I loved, you know, all of that electronic music. You know, I loved Japan. I loved Human League, Visage. And I was really into all of that, just that precision, that beautiful sound. And it sounded so futuristic and it all related back to Kraftwerk and Bowie. Obviously, you know, probably like you, I was a big Bowie fan. Bowie was what we put on before we went out every Saturday, Friday and Saturday night.
Oh, which album?
Changes One.
Right, classic. That was my first album was that compilation.
Yeah.
It was just like, God, that's just so many songs on there, which are just out of this world, from John, I'm Only Dancing to Diamond Dogs to Suffragette City. It was just, it was unbelievable.
Yeah. We'd be getting dressed up, putting on a little bit of slap, because that was what you did in those days. And had Bowie on, we'd be doing shots of whatever was going around, or special brew, and then go out and just like feel fantastic and alive. You know?
Yes, I can't imagine brew making you feel like that. That's like
you try drinking a can of special brew really quickly. it's like having a large whiskey.
Yeah. Oh God, 8% of.
I know it's disgusting. It tastes like fairy liquid, but it was cheap and it. It got the job done.
Yeah, I associate it with Travellers and Crusties, actually, and you know.
But if we kept on it, we would have become Crusties. I reckon.
You would have been on. You would have been in a bus in some lay-by looking for Stonehenge.
Special brew was very much part of the kind of the black culture for teenagers before Red Stripe, before Super Brew. There was Special Brew, and it was a bit of a macho kind of.
Right. Yes. 8% of God, that's disgusting. So when you got the your first single, When You're Sad, this was on One Little Indian. Did this all, it seemed to be coming together incredibly quickly at this stage?
It didn't feel quick for us. It wasn't anywhere quick enough, but we did a demo for those producers who came to our gig, and they just happened to be it just was Ray and Tan Shulman, and they were working with One Little Indian and producing their album, which was like Uncarved Block or Flux of Pink Indians. And he sent it to them and they said, oh, we want to see him play. And we didn't have a band. So we threw together a band. So my sister Maggie, who I'm still working with, and a couple of schoolmates. And we went into a rehearsal room. I think Dan from the Kitchen's Distinction drummed for us. Yeah. And went to a rehearsal room and they came along and one of the typical kind of apocryphal stories, which I even believe myself, where, you know, Derek from One Little Indian said, well, that was fucking shit, let's make a record kind of thing. it was very much like that. But it took ages to do the record, to get the record out. I mean, in reality, I didn't really have a record label. They had a lot of ideas and teepees in their gardens and all these crusty hippie punk anarchists.
Oh, God, yeah, you would have had Mick Farren probably somewhere down the line and... I don't know, perhaps not Mick Farren. He was in the... Pink Fairies, yes.
Yeah, that's different. Pink Indians is a different thing. Pink Indians is very much on the crass scene, the kind of 80s anarcho-punks, Dadaists. If you want my honest truth, a bunch of fucking wankers. But they didn't walk the walk, put it that way. And they're all very, very successful middle-class businessmen now. So that single, I mean, it's massive for us because we had huge expectations, but we didn't realise how hard it was for most bands. And it was really easy for us, but we didn't know anything different until as long as it kept rolling, it seemed normal. It's when it stopped rolling that you notice, shit, other people we know who are starting bands, you know, they're having real difficulties. What's their problem? It's really easy. But then when it stopped being easy, you realise, we were kind of lucky.
Yes.
At the right time.
I think that was the joy of that period, and probably the 90s. There was sort of gatekeepers, weren't there? We had the music press. We had people like John Peel, Janice Long, Kid Jensen.
Definitely.
And things did sort of get going. So you didn't feel like, what's the point? We're still playing in front of our friends, family, and anybody we can emotionally blackmail to see us. You know, you suddenly got people wanting to discover you, which is like, oh, that's nice for you.
Yeah, I mean, it was nice for a small number. You know, we got our first single from One Little Indian, When You're Sad. And Derek said to us, go and sit outside Radio 1 and wait until John Peel comes out. That was marketing. So we did. We sat outside Radio 1 in the rain and waited for a couple of hours until John Peel came out. They said he always comes out of that building and walks down that road to his wherever he plays. And so we sat down there, just at Oxford Circus, and he came out. We ran after him, freaked him out a little bit. I think he did think he was going to get mugged. No doubt about it. But we just gave him a record. He went, I'll stick it on top. He had a big stack of records. And that night he played it.
Amazing. There you go. That's your marketing budget.
It was amazing because, I mean, I've spent, you know, probably the last, well, probably from when I was about 16, listening to John Peel's shows religiously, because you never knew what you were going to get. You never knew what the next record would be. It'd be like U2, then Misty and Roots, then John Cooper Clarke, and then something else. You know, it's just like, everything was good, though.
It was all good.
Even if he didn't like it, it was bloody good because he just had a spirit behind him.
Well, it was I suppose he narrated it, and it was just an interesting thing. So that period when I suppose I used to record every night the John Peel show for 45 minutes of my trusty TDK D90 cassette. Yeah. Just as, because it was too much, you know, when you listen to new stuff, it's just too much on one, the first listen. You need to listen to it a few times. So it was around that point where you had, you know, Ivor Cutler, Daft Bluggie, then you had Augustus Pablo, then you had the Bundu Boys, then the Smiths, then the Fall, you know, and all these bands every night that you just went, all right, I need to listen to that again and work out which one I really like. But
I would go out and buy records based on this one song. One off like Delta 5, that English post-punk band, you know, just like beautiful, two bass players, amazing things, and then, you know, new age hipsters and just like stuff that was so off the wall, but he basically, you know, collated that,
yes,
put it together, curated it, should I say.
But he was always good at finding the great track on that album, and the rest of the album sometimes a bit wish I'd.
But you wonder how he had the time.
Yes, because it was
how
like
did he do it?
The second track on side two that he found, but the rest
of
the album.
Which meant he had dropped the needle all over it to find something that was interesting.
Yes, but then during that period, we not only had the Bundu Boys, who we all loved, but there was also, was it the electro compilations that came out from Morgan Kahn? I just wondered if that kind of technology was starting to filter into your kind of consciousness.
Well, we wasn't really that aware. I mean, we were lucky in that we discovered the drum machine, and then the guy who produced our first single, Ray Shulman, he was in, Gentle Giant?
Oh, my God,
who I didn't know about at all, because they didn't become like Genesis here, but I think they were really big in America and Canada and Japan. But he produced us, and he knew technology, and as well as doing all of the music production, so he could... No, he grew up with the Moog synthesizers, the modular synths and all that, and he knew all the technology. Plus, on top of that, when we went to studio, he had samplers, he had drum machines.
Right.
Like proper ones, not like our little tin pots. And so our first experience was, we play guitars, we're into dub effects, so we had like space echoes and stuff, but he had all the drum machines and the samplers and the keyboards. So he introduced us to all of that technology, so that was just... That was normal for us.
Yes.
What we didn't realise is that most bands hadn't come across that technology. They didn't know it even existed. You know,
God.
I mean, a sampler was a post-production tool in those days. It wasn't a musical instrument, for instance.
Yes. I just didn't know. Gentle Giant had such a massive impact on sort of that musical landscape.
Yeah, so, I mean, Ray, he produced us. He produced the Sundays, our first album. He produced quite a lot of bands. He produced Bjork. Birthday Party. I mean, not Birthday Party, they did Birthday, didn't they? Sugar Cubes, yes. So he oversaw a lot of things that were going on and was very influential
Yes, I suppose it's a bit like the famous Dale Griffith, really, wasn't it? Who used to do all the John Peel sessions from Mott the Hoople. I think he hated all the bands, but had to do it. And most people always said, oh, it was horrible. We just didn't like Dale at all, and he hated us.
Ray was a lovely person to work with. And his wife, Tam, she wasn't the producer, but she would sit there, and she, when it was right, she would smile and just go, yep, got it. And you knew that she was completely 100% on the ball.
Fantastic. That's such a nice relationship.
She would tell you what was cool and what wasn't cool.
And she must have listened to some real dodgy stuff in the 70s.
Yeah, yeah, I expect she probably did. I think she was a bit of a rock chick herself.
Yes, well, it helps if you marry a rock guitarist, I suppose. But look, then 4AD come and get you, and Robin Guthrie produces the next recording, doesn't he? The next session.
Yeah, so we couldn't get any traction with One at Linden. As I said, their marketing budget was us going up to John Peel, and then we didn't have any more budget for any more singles. And by then, we'd probably written 30 songs. We were dying to get going because we were really loving the experience of, like, wow, this is what we were built for, you know, to play music. And so in the end, we had a bit of a bust up with Derek, One at Linden. And at the beginning, he said, oh, you're going to end up on 4AD anyway. So we just said, well, right, let's go and speak to 4AD. So we sent... So we did the Lolita demo and sent it over to Ivo. And Ivo said, yeah, it's great. So we went and spoke to him, and he said, you know, what do you want to do? And it's like, can we get Robin Guthrie to do it? You know, he was God to us.
Yes.
And they said, oh, we'll ask him. And so we did a show, I think it's at the ICA, and Robin and Liz came along. And after the show, Robin said, yeah, I'll do your next single. I thought, oh, my fucking God.
The big time is there, isn't it, actually? So was the first album I, was that the one, or was
no,
it the...
No, we left 4AD after the Mars record debacle. There was a big legal falling out on who owned what. And we had done our next single with 4AD, but we never produced it. We sent a demo of it to Rough Trade, and Rough Trade signed us and did a couple of singles, and then we did 69. That was our first LP.
So before that, Pump Up the Volume, was that, God, actually, is that, what was the story behind that?
Oh, that was a funny one, because we were hanging out with Ray, and Ray was also working with Adrian Sherwood and helping with production on some of the dub reggae stuff that Adrian was doing on New Sounds and Tackhead and African Head Charge and all of that. But they got in with Doug Wimbiss and Keith LeBlanc, who had a rhythm section for the Sugar Hill Gang. And because we were kind of getting quite popular now and we were on 4AD, we knew Adrian because he was a local lad from East London as well. We hung out with him a little bit and we said, you know, would you like to produce a dance track? He said, yeah, I'll produce an Arcane dance track, but I want to get the Sugar Hill Gang guys to be the rhythm section on it. And they were the hottest rhythm section in the world at the time, so we could not believe their luck.
Yes.
So we went to Ivor and we told him what our plan was for the next single. And it wasn't going to be the lead, it was going to be a dance track. We wanted to move into that area. And he said, yeah, I don't really want you to do it with the Sugar Hill Gang. That's a bit obvious. I don't know what he meant by that. He said, it's a bit obvious. It wasn't obvious to us. It was fucking amazing. But he said, I've got a band called Colourbox. And they haven't done anything for a couple of years. And, you know, this might kind of bring them out of their lethargy kind of thing. And so he put us together with Martin from Colourbox.
Yes.
The other guy, Stephen, wasn't around. I'm not sure where he was. I think he might have been a bit of a bender at the time. But so we got together with Martin and we just started playing around with ideas. And he brought in an ambient piano piece that he wanted to do, which was very Harold Budd kind of stuff. And we brought in Annie Tina, which we'd done on a four-track demo. So we said, right, let's start on Annie Tina first. So we did that, and the track was pretty much finished, but he just kind of brought in these really big lush drums and put those over it. And then he put on his ambient piano piece and we said, what the fuck are we going to do with this? So he went away and said, oh, I've got a dance thing as well. And he went away and came up with this dance rhythm. It was basically just a really, really simple kind of like 808 beat. Whoop, 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 whoop. Those kind of famous volume bongo tom-tom drums. And then we started playing around with that and it started to catch fire really, really quickly. And that's when they kicked us out of the studio. We didn't know what was going on. I mean, they'd been around for a long time. But it wasn't a good scene, really, to be honest, because, you know, we all did it together, and then legally they tried to screw us over and say that we didn't own it and all this kind of stuff. So we fell out with 4AD over that, and that's why we left.
Yes, cheesy, crazy. Did you ever get anything sorted out from that kind of hiccup?
Well, they tried to basically write us out of the picture. So, I mean, Ivo's thing was, you should be grateful it's your first time in the studio, second time in the studio. These guys have been around for years. You know, they should get all the accreditation for it. I was like, well, people that should get the accreditation, the people that worked on it, is my opinion.
Yes.
I mean, you know, so it was quite bitter. It wasn't a good split. And Ivo said to me, basically, unless you sign this contract, which basically gives us fuck all, I won't put out your next single, which is the one we took to Rough Trace. I just had to fuck off. And that was the end of that.
That was the end of 4AD. Blimey. Yeah. Cheesy, crazy. It's a tricky world. But then you had dear old Jeff. Jeff from Rough Trade came and saved the day.
Well, Jeff Travis, Jeff, yeah. It's a funny thing, yeah, Jeff knew which side his bread was buttered on, you know, because we were moving serious units and we were in the press every single week. It wasn't really a hard call for him to sign us, to be honest. And that's not me being arrogant, it's just a fact. Even when we weren't doing anything, we were in the press. It was just one of those things because we were quite an unusual looking and sounding band. So Jeff just immediately went, yeah, let's do an album. And I mean, we got on really well with Jeff and Jeanette, who looked after us, and Chris Stoner did the PR and publicity. As the three main characters. Basically he said, how do you want to make this album? And we said, well, we don't want to go into another studio again because we find them a little bit oppressive. Can you just give us an advance? We'll build a studio in Alex's basement. That's what we did. We built a studio and started recording the album.
Yes, this is good. Did you then have kind of, because this is where the kind of the Rough Trade moment starts to go terribly wrong, doesn't it, with their business model? How did that kind of...
Well, that was a few years in, actually. So in 88, we did the 6-9 album. In 89, we did the I album, which was like a double LP, which was mad. And then it kind of went quiet for a couple of years. I built a studio on the proceeds and started working and kind of doing less AR Kane and working more on Hark Records, which is my little record label, and I signed up some bands. And then in the background, all around that, Rough Trade started going down the pan. And it's basically just really, really badly managed company.
Yes.
So a huge amount of theft from the warehouse. And it just, you know, they didn't have their books in order, didn't have their house in order, and you know, it grew quickly. And to a certain extent, its growth was fueled by the Mars record, as was a lot of the indie world at that time. The Mars record kind of opened up new doors. It was the first independent number one, independently distributed number one. The first, so it's Rough Trade's first number one, if you like, and it was 4AD's first number one. And it changed the game for a lot of people. It was a bit like when that Adele record came out, not on the same scale, but when Adele did that album, it kind of injected a boost into the industry.
Yes.
A new dimension. But I think that all of that money, all of the changes and the kind of the slightly cooperative hippie ideals all started to go out the window, and I think there was a lot of friction.
There would have been a lot of friction. Yeah. But then you went back on One Little Indian, didn't you?
No. We didn't go back on One Little Indian. We went to America, David Byrne's invitation, and met David and his label manager, Yale. And we signed a deal to do an album with Luakabop in America.
Yes.
We never went back to One Little Indian. But during that process, Rough Trade went into administration. And they owed a lot of money to Making Records, who were the pressing plant. Making owned or was in association with One Little Indian. There were Brian Bonner from Making and One Little Indian, Derek, they were all tied together. And they basically said, we'll write off your debts if we can have everything. So they took the entire catalogue, and we should have been given our catalogue back, basically. So that's still on dispute. But yeah, they took the entire catalogue for a penny, and we never had a say in it. What I recently discovered was that our contract with Rough Trade was not in perpetuity, and the catalogue actually reverted to us. But, that's still being sorted out.
Yes, I would imagine that's going to be. Is that exciting to sort of be able to?
Well, yes, because I've got people that are going to reissue, you know, lovingly, all of our catalogue, and so I am excited. So that will happen next year.
Yes.
God, it's just sat on the shelf and gathered dust. It's not been exploited. It's not been marketed. It's not been used for anything, really. It's just been sitting there, and you know, so I'm having it back.
So as we were trucking into the 90s, and then suddenly the John Major years, did you at this stage, was this when you decided to put the band on hold?
So I think the juice, we ran out of juice between me and Alex. It just kind of like, it kind of dried up. We did one final album for Luwaka Bop, which was, it didn't have the same feeling. We knew that something had gone. We could have worked through that, but I decided it, and also Alex had moved to California, and so I moved out there to work with him, but I didn't really like it that much, to be honest. I didn't really do California. It's a great place to visit, America is not a great place for me to live. And I think that I had kids coming at the same time, and it's like, do I really want to grow up here? I don't think so. And now I'm pleased that I made that decision.
Yes.
But yeah, so that the relationship between me and Alex, the creative relationship, kind of dried up. So I just thought, well, I'm going to go and do something else. I went back to England, and obviously Maggie had been working in acclaim from the beginning, doing backing vocals and some lead vocals and so on. So I just said, well, this is an easy fit. Me and Maggie, why don't we just make a little album together? So we did an album for Virgin, the Monica Sufi, and then we did one for Secret Agent Records, a guy called Guy Sermon.
Yes.
And we did another album for him, and then we just kind of pootled about a bit, really. And then I just thought, you know what, it's time to just grow the family properly. So I opted out of the music industry pretty much wholesale, and just thought, right, I'm going to get a computer, I'm going to teach myself some new skills, and I'm going to start working. I'm going to get a proper job.
Yes. So was that from the sort of mid
to late 90s, yeah.
Right.
I never completely stopped doing music. I've always had a little studio set up at home, and I tinkered. But it wasn't until 2015 that I started to kind of inject energy back into it properly. Started doing shows again and doing new recordings and so on.
Yes. God, this does happen, doesn't it? This is a great, you know, this is a story that I've heard once or twice where people just thought, you know, we've been in this band for a long time. I've fallen out with everyone. The industry, the business hasn't been good, and we've got no money. So I've had enough of it. I'm just going to go and get a job and do other things. So, yes.
It does happen. And it's like, I was still doing music and playing some little shows and stuff. But I just thought, in order to make this, you know, financially viable, I'm going to have to do a lot more work on the music industry, which means it means I'm going to take me away from home. And I had two small kids. And that, and it was that dad decision. It's like, probably not the best way to bring up your kids if you're not around ever.
No, it's not a good story, is it? It never finishes well. Yeah. So then when you got back and you were working with your sister and the guitarist, Andy Taylor, is this the Andy Taylor?
No, what, from Duran Duran? No, it's not. Andy Taylor, this is many years later. It's like Andy Taylor lived two doors down from me. And he was my daughter's best friend.
Right.
That shows the age difference. And he was a young lad. And it just one evening, he came round for dinner and just picked up the guitar and started singing and playing. I went, oh, my fucking God. Come on, then. Love it. And so we decided to do some concerts together. We did like a mini European tour. And then we thought, well, let's just make an album. So we did it. We played as Arcane. But then when it came around to doing the album, didn't feel quite right doing it at that time as Arcane. I didn't feel like I'd really earned that, to do that without Alex.
Yes.
So I went out as Jubal. But it's about 7 years on since then now, and I've pretty much achieved the Arcane status. So probably the next recording will be Arcane.
Because you did quite a few singles, Thinking Sweet and Quiet Sun Slips Over, which were... which came out. And
yeah, well, the problem for us is that we were planning to put them out, do the PR and the press, and then do the concerts, and then pandemic came along.
Yes, it just
went flat, and there was no way of actually doing anything with it. So I would say it's a major flop. It washed its own back, as they say, and washed its own face. But it should have been. In my opinion, it's a very good album, which in my opinion is worth little because I actually made it. So I kind of put that one down to experience. Really, there's not really much you can do about that.
No, that came out. Was that DNA Cowboys? Which was
DNA
kind of...
Cowboys? Yeah, Christ. So that was a fun album to make. And it was a really creative time. It happened very, very quickly. So I don't know if I'll do another Jubal record. The next recording will probably be as AR Kane.
So is it the case that Alex is kind of happy for you to just take the baton of the name and just say, look, just do what you want?
Don't really know. I mean, when I said to him that we're playing live, do you want to come and join us? He said, no, but good luck to you, kind of thing.
Said, right.
That's that. Yeah. He doesn't do music anymore. Not quite sure what he does. I think he might have gone back into advertising.
Yes. Is it, you know, because it's like I mentioned right at the beginning, it's interesting that with a lot of the people that I've been interviewing, they did their thing and then went, oh, well, never mind. And then decades later, people have come back and went, my God, this is really amazing. You know, we really appreciate it even more now. Have you started to find more followers? Because you have such amazing critical acclaim, don't you? I mean, everyone's been kind of, you know, influenced by AR Kane.
Yeah, but we're very much a musician's band, I think. We don't have a huge following. People that do like AR Kane tend to be other musicians.
Right.
Or producers or somebody on the music scene. They're real music lovers. It's not pop music as such. So I don't know what numbers are, but there's always been interest. And at the moment, there's a lot of label interest, which is interesting because it's like going back to the 80s again. Suddenly it's like, oh, we did a show on Saturday, and afterwards a couple of people said to me, would you like a record deal? And it's just like, oh, this is so fucking funny. It's like, I'm not 20 years old anymore.
But it's interesting how many labels there are now that are just curating a lot of bands from the 80s. There's tiny global productions, I think they're called, and it's like, oh God, your roster is just like, you know, really good musicians who've done the sort of stuff in the 80s, got done over a bit, and then said, look, if you want to do any more albums, you know, I'd love to put you out on our roster, you know, we've got a great kind of catalogue. So it is interesting. Yeah. There is a kind of a generation now of, I suppose, label managers who know how to do it. We'll say, look, let's split it 50-50, but, you know, we'd love to just help you for the next album. And most artists like, I'd love to do it, but I really don't want to do all this work myself. I just want to make the music, but let someone else do it. So I just wondered if that's going to be the case for you.
Yeah, well, I'm trying to find a balance because I've had lots of conversations recently. I put out a thing on Facebook just showing some of the old tapes that I'd found in storage, and like the half-inch tapes and multi-tracks and stuff. And I said, does anyone fancy like looking after these, giving them a bit of love, putting them out again? And I've had a lot of people contact me, say, from people who will clean them up, bake them, transferred. You know, you have to bake the tapes, don't you?
Yes, I've heard about the baking.
Some people who will do box sets and, you know, all this kind of stuff, T-shirts. And it's like, wow, that's really amazing. So I'm trying to find a balance between playing live, doing new recordings, and then looking after the heritage stuff.
Yes.
At the same time, and finding different homes for different things, really. So that's going really quite well. So next year should be really interesting. It should be nice.
So is it the case that you now own all the catalogue and yes. Alex, and then you'll just want to get somebody to say, look, can we have a vinyl box set, you know, CD, you know, everything, just have it nicely archived?
Yeah, that's it.
Basically, there you go. And sort of going forward, is it mostly now you and Maggie, your sister, and potentially Andy on guitar?
So Andy's moved north of England, so it's not feasible anymore. We can't really work together, but he may come back some little bits and pieces. I think the core will be me and Maggie, and additional to that, there'll be kind of remixes. I've spoken to some remixes already for some of the earlier tracks, and I will collaborate in all likelihoods. There's quite a lot of people out there that I think that I know are interested in doing little collaborations. So I'll probably just bring featured artists in from time to time.
I would imagine loads of people are going to want to be on your next album, aren't they?
I don't know. It's a lovely thought. And I've got a few people in mind that I would use for various things, like whether it be a bass player or a vocalist or something.
You built your own studio at home?
Oh, I don't really have a studio as such. I mean,
a living room.
I have like a keyboard, a little mixer, some little gadgets. I've got my big old speakers.
There you go.
I've got my guitars. I'm in the front room. I only moved here a little while ago, and it's quite a small house. And, I just took over the front room and turned it into a studio. So I rehearse in here and I write in here.
And does it come as easily now as it did back in the 80s, the ideas?
Yeah. I don't think that changes really. I mean, it's a big area, isn't it? Creativity.
Well, bizarrely, there's a few people who have, I don't know if you ever came across a guy called Nick Evans, who was part of, you know, various record labels in the late 80s and early 90s. But he's got a whole thing on creativity and his soul. And also the guy from Bid from the Monochrome Sets that he's writing a book on creativity and the whole theories he's got behind it, which it sounded fascinating. So, yes, creativity, where does it come from? Do you ever lose it?
Yes, you do. Or you lose the ability to express, or maybe you don't have anything to express. But I think that it was interesting for me because when I wasn't doing music, I started painting. And I think that you see that in a lot of musicians. If they stop doing one creative outlet, they find another one which is more conducive to their environment. So I started drawing and painting. And what I found with, it's easier to get my head around creativity through the plastic arts, in that you can see a clear progression in a really short period of time.
Yes,
of where you're going and the kind of aesthetic which is guiding you, and the removal of like artifice and getting closer and more and more towards something. I think musically you do that as well, but I think with me, and I can't really speak for anybody else, in terms of musical creativity, there has to be a certain minimum level of like something around me, like a base, if you like. Things have to be sorted to a certain extent. If I can't pay the bills, it's harder to do it, write a song, unless you're writing a song about being unable to pay the bills. So there's a certain baseline that I have to get to where family's okay and I feel a bit okay. And it might be a luxury, but you know, some people work better under extreme stress.
I think when you're younger, you might be able to deal with that level of potential poverty and desperation, but I think as you get older it's harder.
I mean, when we started ARK and I had no heating, I had broken windows, I was in a semi-squat, and I had no money for food, and I quite often I didn't eat for a couple of days, so there is that. But I had a lot of dreams, a lot of energy, and you know, those things didn't bother me so much. I was immortal, as we all are when we're young. Nowadays, I'm lucky to be able to have a room like this whereby, you know, I can switch it all on and then just get into it. You know, but in terms of the actual technique, you have to have technique. You have to have the skills to do that. And, you know, over the years, I've developed those skills. But in terms of the actual desire to write something and to reflect on the thing, is this good, is this bad, that discrimination, I think every individual has that to a greater or lesser extent. I think if you're going to be a musician, you have to be able to discriminate between what's useful, what's not, and when it's finished, probably.
Yes.
Have we finished this song yet?
Did you ever have problems with that? Because I know, speaking to a few people, it's like, they go, God, I really wish we could have just moved on a bit quicker once we'd done what we needed to, rather than just go, no, let's go back and sort of fiddle around a bit more with it. And it's like, that kind of energy kind of gets a bit sort of, I don't know, it doesn't flow so much. It's a bit like,
I think we've got,
it's kind of, we've got the idea, we could spend another year, but it's not really going to change that much. And actually we need to then move on as a creative person. Whereas it's like, Christ, are we still working on this song, which is, it's starting to sound worse than it did a year ago.
Yeah, I think it's, Yeah, it is interesting. I remember seeing some Jackson Pollock documentary, and towards the end, his action paintings, as they were called, they were just like monochrome, and they were done in seconds, and they had as much power, you know. And I think it's like, you know, it's like we were doing a show last Saturday, and the Saturday before, I put on a drum groove, and I said, Maggie, should we try a song over this drum groove? And we tried it, and in one take rehearsal, I just sung it. I said, just follow me. Every time I do a line, copy it. And she did it. And at the end, I was like, right, that's on the set. You know, and it's just to not really care so much, but to care in a different kind of way, to not be precious about it. I do think things, a lot of musicians I know, they will spend months and months working on a new release. Seriously, you should have done it in one weekend. And if someone put a gun against your head and said, do it in one weekend, you would.
Yeah.
You could. You know, if someone said to me, I want an album a week from now, they'll get 10 songs if my life depended on it. And I think sometimes we just have to behave as if it does.
Well, I think the David Bowie Black Star album probably had that kind of urgency that is like, it's quite ambitious. It's kind of like, wow, that must have been incredible. But you must have also known you were needed to finish it before you were going to die. So you needed to keep on with it. It's like, you've got the idea, let's just get to the next idea.
I still have yet to listen to that whole album.
it's a tricky album at times. But it's interesting with that painting thing, because I always remember, I think it was Joni Mitchell was next to some famous artist, or was talking about this guy who, I can't remember what his name was actually, but he was very famous, and he sort of done his little drawing, and someone said, God, that's an incredible masterpiece. You did that in, I don't know, 5 minutes. He goes, no, that was 50 years. That was... Yeah. You know, that's not just 5 minutes. That's my whole life that has been, you know, put into this little piece of this scribble.
Yeah. It's not... Picasso used to draw.
But that's the one. Sketch. It's Picasso.
Yeah, you know, drew, is it Lupo, his little dog? And, you know, things like that. Just do a quick sketch. Boom.
There you go. But it's more than just 5 minutes. It was like, you know, all
that. I think, without trying to sound arrogant, I think if you've been working in music for almost 40 years, you ought to have some skills which are just like there. You know, you don't think about riding a bike once you've learned to ride it. You just get on and do it. And I think that cutting to the chase is really, really important, I think, nowadays. I mean, I've less energy and less time.
Yeah, and also when you look at the 60s work, you know, those bands were bringing out an album a year, doing a tour, and David Bowie in the 70s did 10 albums in 10 years, did world tours, relocated, got married, got divorced, you know, I mean, and starred in various films. So there was an urgency there, wasn't there? There wasn't that kind of, shall we just do that again? It's like, no, I'm just going to be, I'm doing soul in Philly.
Here's the thing, the whole DIY ethic evolved through technology. That was the next stage, wasn't it? You can get a sampler, you don't need a band, you can sample something else, and you can develop all your stuff, until the technology took over. And now I mean, my son's a producer, not to be critical of him, he produces really nice music, but he's enough labour it, you know, because he's got his computer and his software, and it's all inside there. And so he can work it and work it and work it and work it. I mean, so he puts a lot of time into that tiny little sound that's on the third bar, and this, that, and the other. It's like, whereas we never had that luxury.
No.
So we worked quicker, but it's different strokes, isn't it, really?
But it's that kind of, wow, that is a song that's going to be, that's got something else. It's the, as the Trog said in the studio, you know, it's the fairy dust, isn't it? The magic fairy dust on the production. But if the song isn't there, it's like, no, that just...
Well, that's a whole different area, isn't it? Is it songs? Is it music? I mean, I have this dream that I will one day build this kind of machine, and it's like an algorithm, basically. And so it has four main feeds, and they're music. So there's the lyric, the rhythmic, the sonic, and the melodic. And that all songs are made up of different elements to a large extent of that. And then within those, there's, you know, if you're going to push the rhythmic up as a slider, you're moving more into like rhythm dance. If you're going to push the lyric up, you might be going into Bob Dylan territory or rap.
Yes.
If you're going to push the sonic up, you move into A.R. Kane space, if that sounds and noise. And then, you know, melodic, you might be looking at Bach even. But then you take that algorithm, you feed that in, you feed that through genre, through era, through attitude, through politics, and you can come up with almost any type of music. as just basically moving sliders and knobs. And I think that that's very much so what is a song? It's really, it's almost, not to criticize it, but what is a song? You know, almost like the wrong question. It's like, what are the component parts of this piece of music that you're creating?
Yes.
Where's the emphasis? And, you know, so Tubular Bells isn't a song as such, but it's an amazing piece of music. It's more like classical, isn't it? It's more about melody and rhythm, you know. So those sliders have been pushed up really, really high, but there's no lyrics.
Yes.
To zero. You know, and sometimes I think about it like that, but I am very much, I sit down with an acoustic guitar and I write a song. That's the root of nearly everything that I do. So I understand it, because that's what hooked me in. It's like going back to where we started when we were kids in the 70s. It was all songs. They were all beautiful pop songs. And I still, like, on a sunny Sunday afternoon when I'm cooking, I might put on like a 70s playlist or something, because all those songs hook you right back into a certain vibe.
Yes.
No, but there is songwriting and there's music created. And they cross over, but not necessarily the same thing.
It's a tricky one, though, isn't it? I mean, if you could have just said something to your, like, a 16-year-old self starting out, is there anything that you'd have just kind of wanted to whisper in their ear, even if that person...
Get a lawyer.
Get a lawyer.
Yeah, probably. It would have been, you know, starting out in terms of music. It's difficult to respond to that without being cynical or humorous.
Yes.
Sarcastic, isn't it? But, no. I don't know. I don't. Musically, I wouldn't change anything really. Pretty happy with.
Yes. Well, it does sound brilliant. Well, I'm really excited that you've got projects for next year. This has been fantastic. So there you go.
But I'm glad we managed to catch up eventually.
Yes, I know.
I didn't have anything to talk about before, but now I'm doing new things. It's like I try not to do press or anything like that if there's nothing really to talk about that's new.
No, but anyway, this is brilliant. Well, thank you ever so much. I'll let you rock on. But yes, this worked brilliantly. And if you want, I can always send you the link, and then you can always use it on one of your social media platform sites.
Brilliant.
If you want. Anyway, but look, thanks a lot. And have a really, really lovely day. Try and keep cool.
Okay. Take care, David.
Keep the curtains closed. That's our tip.
Yeah, that's what I'm doing. Okay.
And close it. See you. Bye. Bye. And that, dear listener, is how you end a conversation. Well, not really. But anyway, it keeps me amused. A massive thank you to Rudy Tambala to give me the time for that interview. I'm so grateful. Yes, AR Kane, check it out. Check them out. I do believe you can find them on or him on Facebook. Also on, you know, just Google, you'll find something about them and the website as well. Anyway, this is the C86 Show. I'm David East. So if you want to contact me for some nice reason, you can on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, just do C86 Show. Also, these have all been archived. Aren't you lucky? You can find those on Spotify, iTunes, Podbean. It's true. Anyway, look, have a great week. Stay safe.